Welcome back to our flagship studios at the 2024 J.P. Morgan Healthcare Conference. I am here with Adrian Gottschalk of Foghorn Therapeutics. Great to have you back on this stage again this year.
Pleasure to be here with you.
Great. So Adrian, can you start by telling us, introducing us to chromatin biology? What does that mean, and what does that mean for the therapeutics that you might be developing and patients?
Absolutely. So, we're focused on a very unique piece of biology called the chromatin regulatory system. This is a system that effectively orchestrates gene expression. It's controlling when, where, and how genes are turned on, turned off. And this piece of biology was, for a long time, thought to be playing a housekeeping function, not really relevant in disease. Sort of you needed it, but it was sort of an afterthought, if you will.
Okay.
And what I think, the work of our scientific founder and the field and other work that we've done over the intervening period has shown is this biology is exceptionally relevant.
Mm.
Certainly in oncology, but also potentially in other disease areas. Maybe to take a step back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, chromatin is the compacted form of your DNA, right? You gotta take-
Okay...
the 3 meters or so of your DNA.
Mm-hmm.
If you took all the base pairs and lined it up end to end-
Yep...
you gotta take 3 meters of DNA and compress it about a million times to get it to fit into the nucleus of all of the 33 or so trillion of your cells, right? So you can imagine that this is information effectively that is compacted, compressed, and you need a system that opens up the very specific areas of that packaging-
Mm-hmm...
to allow the genes to be expressed and therefore to function, right? So, you want your heart cells to run the heart cell gene expression programs. You want your brain cells to run the brain cell gene expression programs. And you can imagine that when this goes awry, the wrong genes are turned on or turned off at the wrong and inappropriate time, and hence you get things, diseases like cancer, but also neurodegeneration, autoimmune disorders. There's a whole plethora of impacts, as one can imagine, when the wrong genes are expressed at the wrong point in time. So Foghorn, you know, has taken the approach to really study this biology. And again, if you take a step back, this was an area that was inaccessible-
Mm-hmm...
for drug discovery, and in part because people didn't know how to study it. And if you can't study something-
Sure...
you don't actually know where to go look to target the right area of the biology, and then if you can't target it, you don't know how to develop medicines for it. So what we've built over the course of now, but over 7.5 or so years, is a platform. It's, we call it the Gene Traffic Control Platform. It allows us to interrogate this biology, and consequently, as we're trying to study it, we've been able to understand different aspects of it-
Okay...
I believe, better than almost anyone else in the world. And that's allowed us to develop medicines. These are small molecule drugs.
Okay.
We can get into that a little bit as we go.
Yeah.
We've been able to develop a very robust pipeline, with a lot of interesting, new targets that folks have really wrestled with in the industry in terms of drugging. So we're very excited about the potential of this biology. I always think about it in a simple form of unique biology, precision medicine-
Mm-hmm...
with a broad impact.
Okay.
That's what we're trying to do at Foghorn.
Well, you touched on one of the questions that I had for you, was why are small molecules the right choice for Foghorn in terms of targeting that biology and the medicines that you're thinking of bringing to market? Why small molecules?
Sure. So, there are certainly different modalities-
Yeah...
that we can think about over time, but most of this-
Okay...
biology obviously is happening within the cell, inside the cell.
So you need to get in there.
You've got to get inside the cell.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's different ways you can do that. There's other interesting things you can do with antibodies, but by and large, we've got to get inside the cell-
Mm-hmm...
sometimes inside the nucleus of the cell.
Mm-hmm.
And so, that lends itself to a small molecule-based approach.
Great.
I like to often say that we're a biology-first, small molecule modality-agnostic company.
Huh.
What I mean by the biology first hopefully is self-explanatory, but the small molecule modality agnostic means that we can take different approaches with small molecules, right? So you've got-
Okay...
a classical approach of enzyme inhibition-
Mm-hmm...
right? That happens to be our 286 program that we can talk about. But we've also built significant capabilities in protein degradation, right?
Okay.
Using small molecules to target specific proteins that then take those proteins to the cell's recycling bin or the rubbish bin to degrade them and chew them up. We can also look at using small molecules to disrupt the interactions between proteins. So we become very, very facile with the chemistry in this area. So hence the modality, the small molecule modality
agnostic. Great. So continuing on that train of thought, tell us about 286, where it is today. I understand you're in AML. How is that biology working in AML and what you're looking forward to in 2024 with that program?
Right. This is a really exciting program for us. This is FHD-286. It is a small molecule medicine that targets two proteins, actually, with the same small molecule. And it's targeting a really important part of this chromatin regulatory system. This is the engines of one of these remodeling complexes that is opening and closing chromatin and allowing the genes to be turned on and off. Mm. In AML in specific, which as you said, this drug is now in a combination study in relapsed refractory AML. Mm-hmm. We had previously run a monotherapy study where we saw a differentiation syndrome which is associated with the drug differentiating these AML cells. So again, let's take a step back. So in AML, there's two different ways predominantly to get at the cancer. You can do it the historical way in chemotherapy where you're just trying to kill the cells outright. Yeah. The other approach, which is an elegant way of doing this, is you're trying to differentiate the cancer. You're trying to change the cancer cell from being a cancer cell into a more normal looking cell, right? AML, right, is a disease of the lineage progenitor cells in your bone marrow that are forming the various immune cells, neutrophils, macrophages can impact the cells that make your platelets as well. Mm-hmm. And so what we've observed, what we saw in the first part of our study is that this agent is actually differentiating these cancer cells. It's causing them to turn into the more normal cells. So we're now running this combination study with 286 plus another agent, decitabine in this case. And the goal is obviously to see if we can cause people to get into remission or get them to have complete responses in AML. This study is enrolling really nicely. We're open at multiple centers, some of the largest academic cancer centers in the United States.
Great.
And we anticipate having our data here in the second half of 2024. The other thing I would be remiss in mentioning with 286 is that we believe this could be broadly used in other cancers as well. So we've generated a host of preclinical data that indicates that there's opportunities maybe in non-small cell cancer, potentially in prostate cancer. And some recent work by our scientific founder has highlighted that combination of 286 with tyrosine kinase inhibitors, these TKI inhibitors, you would think of this as osimertinib, which is used in EGFR, lung cancer, the KRAS medicines that are now available. We believe that 286 has the potential to combine with those agents for patients who have previously been on them and become refractory to them. So we, as well as our scientific finder, are doing a bunch of preclinical work there. We're looking to explore that opportunity preclinically, and then we'll see where we go from there. But I think the story on 286 actually is just beginning.
Yeah.
And I think there's a lot of potential for this asset as we move forward.
Wonderful. A lot of different pipeline applications potentially from where
you
are today.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, actually, that answers another one of my questions was, where do you see the pipeline evolving over the next 12, 18, 24 months? Will you focus just on 286 or are there other molecules that are coming down the pike?
Yeah, no, great question. The beauty of what we have built at Foghorn is I like to think of it as a little big pharma in the sense that we've got a pipeline of 10 or so different programs. 286 obviously is in the clinic at this point. Mm-hmm. We have a really important strategic collaboration with our colleagues at Loxo at Lilly. Mm-hmm. That's five programs at present. Only one of them we have disclosed. It's a selective inhibitor of BRM, which is a really important protein, again, in one of these remodeling complexes. That is a program that we have actually transitioned to our colleagues there at Loxo Lilly. We did that in Q3 of last year. That triggered a 50-50 cost sharing with them. And then there's four other programs on which we're working with them. So can't get into that for probably the obvious reasons. So that's a really important part of what we've been doing at Foghorn in that important collaboration. Behind that, we have other proprietary programs. I'll just mention a few of them. There's three in particular that we're really excited about that are at certain different stages. One of them is a program called CBP. The other's a program called EP300. And then the third one is called ARID1B. These are all really, really important targets within the regulation of chromatin biology. I believe we are unique in our ability to selectively drug these programs, these targets. And so in specific for CBP and EP300, we actually at in our latest investor deck and in our press release at the kickoff at JP Morgan, we've put out some new preclinical data there that really highlights our ability to selectively drug these and at least preclinically drug them without some of the side effects that others have seen when they're drugging these targets. So we're really excited about those programs. We're on track to get to IND-enabling tox studies on CBP. EP300 is a little bit behind that, but we're going to do everything we can to accelerate that. And then that third program I mentioned, ARID1B, is amongst the most mutated targets in this chromatin biology. It's actually one of the top potential targets in cancer. We know firsthand from talking to other companies, large pharmas that have looked at this, they've beat their head against the wall trying to drug it. We've been able to successfully find selective chemical matter. We're in the process of turning that into that degrader small molecules I've talked about. So really excited about what's coming over the course of this year. And the goal is to have roughly about six or so new INDs between now in the next 3 to 4 years. So it's certainly not just about 286. We're really excited about that program. But I think there's a whole bunch of different things coming down the pike for us. And we're excited to be the ones at the forefront of this biology.
Very exciting. That sounds wonderful. Well, thank you very much, Adrian, for being here. It sounds like you've got a really exciting and differentiated and precise way to add to the arsenal of tools that we have at our disposal to treat disease.
Absolutely.
Thank you for joining us.
We look forward to making a difference. Thanks for having me.
Great.